Dr. Yuna Rian to come forward. We have to thank Professor Ben Miller, the 2010 recipient of the Future of Health Technology Award, for the honor of having Dr. Rian with us today. Dr. Rian is the CEO of Diagnostics for All. She has an extensive background in leading biotech companies and was formerly the CEO of Avant Immunotherapeutics. Dr. Rian is also research professor of medicine at Boston University School of Medicine. She serves on a number of boards, including Business Advisory Board of BioVentures for Global Health. Dr. Rian is past chair of the Massachusetts Biotechnology Council. She holds a PhD degree in cellular and molecular biology from Cambridge University in England and received an honorary Doctor of Science degree from Bristol University in 2009. She's also a recipient of Albert Einstein Award for Achievement in the Life Sciences, and Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II awarded her the Order of the British Empire for her service to the research, development, and promotion of biotechnology. She has written over 500 original papers and 11 books, and it's a great honor to have you with us today. Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you very much, Renata. When people give you these wonderful introductions, I think actually it's the bad things that happen to you in life that actually predict what you're going to do later. So don't remember all of that. Think of me as a little baby born in an air raid shelter escaping from the enemy. And those are the things I think that drive us. I was very impressed with all of the previous talks, and I'm probably going to gather a word from each of them. And I think as we look at the future, which is what we're supposed to be doing today, and I spend a lot of time thinking about the future of health tech, it's important to look at the past as well. And some of the ancients had a lot of wisdom about healthcare, and I think it's worth drawing on that as well. So I'm a huge believer in looking at the complex tangle of possibilities that come out of crisis. Everybody has slightly different version of reading these signs. I'm only half Chinese, but I think I can get it about half right. The other thing that I want to say is that I don't spend any time worrying about glass ceilings or political things or anything like that. There are huge things to be overcome, and it's important to remember that 60% of the world's people cannot walk to healthcare, not for these reasons, but they live beyond the reach of our large urban medical centers and our large central laboratories. So when times are tough for starting companies, for employing people, doing all the things we want to do now, I think it's very important to think of others and how they might be helped. And some of the things that came out of the previous talks that I think are very important, in Renata's list of seven things, there was really only one word that spoke to me, and that was affordable. Healthcare can be magnificent technologically, but it's not going to be useful if everybody can't afford it. And the other, several people, the last two speakers, alluded to, and this is the concept of empowered self-help. There's a huge resource out there. It's us, we, the patients. And I think it's absolutely time to get back to, and I say get back to, looking after ourselves. Victorian women knew how to cure headaches, abort babies, get rid of husbands, do all sorts of useful things that people now go to lawyers and doctors to do. So what I want to talk to you about today is, they used to get rid of missionaries too. what I want to talk to you about today is one way of looking at changing the way we think about healthcare. And if you want to manage the health of a person, a patient, or of a population, you really have to know what you're dealing with. And that gets you quite quickly to accurate and reproducible, storable diagnostics. And sometimes the lessons, as I said, come from the past. Sometimes the lessons come from the less fortunate parts of the world. And if you look at the effects of the lack of diagnostic testing in the developing world, where diagnostics are frequently considered too expensive or too unreliable, you see not just that you get sick people because they're not treated, but sometimes they're being given the wrong drugs, and sometimes those wrong drugs lead to very harmful side effects that might have been worth it in a disease setting and are certainly not otherwise, and they're definitely leading to the buildup of drug resistance. So just let me give you an example. If you're a mother in the developing world and you come in with a sick baby with a fever, you will almost certainly, if you're lucky to get anything at all, be given an anti-malarial. But only 50% of the time will your child actually have malaria. So I think you can see that there are a lot of sick people who could be treated and people who are being treated who are not the best patients. So we wanted to get to the bottom of this kind of problem. And our answer is here. The answer is a postage stamp sized diagnostic test. Now, the MIT Faculty Club is much too classy for me to do a good demonstration on this, but if you were to have paper napkins, and if you were to have spilled your coffee or your water on a paper napkin, it would fill out in a big blob that would grow. And that is wicking on paper. And what we're doing here is using microfluidics, which is a way of printing small channels on pieces of paper to direct the movement of that fluid just down the channels where we want it to go, not to spread out in a big blob. So what we have is a device that's pretty much like lab on a chip. But when you have lab on a chip, it has to fit into a big device about the size or larger of that projector, all hooked up by wires, needing somebody skilled not only to use it, but also to fix it when it breaks, which it will. This, if it doesn't work, throw it away and use another, because it costs, I'll show you, less than a penny. So we don't need any power, meaning electricity, just wicking power to drive the reaction. Don't need any clean water, which is often in short supply, and we don't need a doctor. So we have something that's incredibly inexpensive, can be used at the point of care by self. It works immediately, so you see the result. You can carry hundreds of them in your pocket. I don't know what other women carry in their purse. I carry these around with me. It's also disposable. In the developing world, people just use a match. Almost everything is incinerated. And most importantly, it's scalable. I come from the vaccines industry, and we were always able to make vaccines, whether for anthrax and plague, or in my particular case, rotavirus, in fairly low quantities. But when you scale up, you come up against huge problems. These, print them. And let me show you a little bit, in a rather obvious way, how it could work. And in fact, we use something much more complicated now. So if you were to put a drop of blood or urine, it will flow along the microfluidic channels we've printed to some zones or areas where we have pre-spotted dyes, reactants, antibodies, various reagents. And the picture on the right is just to show you how incredibly flexible, changeable, iterative this technology is. It's not requiring a huge plant with expensive equipment. It simply requires your imagination. Now, when you think about it, this is the kind of technology that's been around for a while. If you go to any poor part of any city in the world, and unfortunately, even in wilderness areas, the one thing you will see blowing around is cheaply printed colored paper, usually comic books. And actually, I like Spider-Man, so I was happy to put him up here. But comic book printing technology is easy, it's ubiquitous, and one can learn a lot of lessons from printing. So the way we make these little devices and make them so cheaply is with some extraordinary equipment, a computer, a printer, and an oven. And so, as I said, all it takes is your imagination. You can use Mac Draw or Adobe. We tend to use much more sophisticated technology and software for drawing our devices, but you don't have to. And so you design the channels that you want. How many you want on there, how many layers you need for the different reactions. You have to be able to hit print. So it's very skilled. And then it costs about a 300th of a cent to print on regular paper. We use Wattman filter paper, but you could use toilet paper if you wanted to. We don't like that expensive Xerox paper because it becomes more hydrophobic and it doesn't flow as well. So first you design the picture you want, then you print. We use a solid wax printing method, but this is a standard Xerox printer, costs about $800, and it's not modified beyond that. Could be, but it doesn't have to be. And so you've now got a wax layer printed on the paper, and then you go to your next sophisticated device, which is a hot plate or an oven, and then you make the hydrophobic barrier, the wax, flow through, and you can do this absolutely programmably to the back. Wax is very useful. We can play some other tricks with it. And then this is just food coloring. You can see that the channels are watertight. This is somebody else's computer. And we print, as you would print, sheets of stamps. It's a little more complicated than I'm making it sound. We have several layers and they're laminated. They have to be in register. And all we do now is this semi-automated sheet-fed process. When we get to billions or hundreds of millions of devices needed, we can fairly smoothly scale up to roll-to-roll printing like newspapers use and many diagnostics companies use. So the actual process of printing costs much less than a cent. Of course, now you've got to add reagents. I'll show you. You have to add some complexity to it. Now, the picture I showed you was largely lateral flow. We do not really use lateral flow. We use Z-direction flow most of the time. And this technology came from the laboratory of George Whitesides here at Harvard. And we have done quite a lot to develop it since then. So if you want to split the sample, make it run down a certain channel, either mixing or not mixing with other reagents in the paper, it's perfectly easy to do it. So by piling layers of paper, I think this one is 5 or 7, you can very easily make a series of complex reactions of the type that you would require several milliliters of blood in a tube and several tubes and probably several days to do. Now, we actually can go up to split up to 1,000 points, so you can get something close to a barcode. But I think you can see quite easily from a single sample, usually 30 microliters from a finger stick, more from urine, can be saliva, sweat, stool, almost any body fluid. Now, diagnostics in our day and age roughly fall into 4 categories. There are clinical chemistry assays, which are the simplest, so they're just chemistry, and usually they have some kind of readout, either a dye or an electrical signal. And you can do very similar things with immunoassay, electrochemical assays, of which perhaps the best known is a glucose test, and now, as several people have mentioned, the need for biomarkers and for molecular diagnostics, particularly in the field of cancer, but also in infectious disease in every area. It may seem amazing that this simple little piece of paper that costs so little and just looks like a postage stamp, it can in fact do all of these kinds of technologies just on this one platform. I'm always reminded of Dolly Parton's comment that takes a lot of money to look this cheap. I would say they don't cost much, but it costs us a lot of research money to make them. So we need quite a bit of support to make each dot on there. But now to use it, unfortunately, they now work. So it used to be I could go around the table and get volunteers and stick fingers, and we got into an awkward situation once with some, well, not once, with some important visitors where we really did diagnose a problem with the liver. So I've stopped doing it. So I'll show you the picture. You prick your finger. You put it on the back of the device, you turn it over, you read the results. Now, it seems to me if you can tell when the beer is cold, when it goes blue, you can read our tests. But people always say to me, well, what if you're colorblind? Well, the answer is you can use the matching guide, you can ask your neighbor, or you can take a picture of it with your cell phone and email it to someone or to a doctor. I'm going to come back to telemedicine in a minute, but it's very easy to read it. Now, I think that the point I want to make is that I want to get this kind of simple recognition of your own health and disease back into people's hands. People are now quite willing to do pregnancy tests themselves. People are, they don't really enjoy it, but people will monitor their glucose many times a day themselves. There are many other tests that, where it is not dangerous for patients to do it for themselves. There is always a safety check. You can always have this reread. You can have the patient go to a clinic and check it themselves. You can have somebody go to the patient. But remember that a lot of the work we do at Diagnostics for All is really designed specifically for the developing world, where, as I said, people can't always walk to their care easily. It may take them several days to get there, so they need the result immediately. Americans are always so impatient, it seems, but on Diagnostics, my daughter's just had a baby, and she would wait 10 days for her thyroid results to come back. And concerns about preeclampsia. I gave her some of these chips. I said, go pee on them. It's not that difficult. There are a lot of things we could do ourselves. So what we started out with, and it's really my background, is human health. So I have a number of different devices here that I can show you. Human health can be more than just a diagnostic. Is it a, do you have the disease or not? There are many shades of gray. And we also have a pharmaceutical partner with whom we're making tests to be used in clinical trials to lower the costs of clinical trials. And you can put dried blood spots on the back of it as well. So just as with the 1918 flu, you can come back and reinterrogate it later. So I'm a huge believer in point of care, empowering patients to be compliant with behaviors and drugs that they have been told about. It's extremely important that they monitor, for example, liver damage to their to the drugs that they are taking, particularly for HIV and TB and things like that. But it amuses me that point of care can go beyond that to point of cow. And so we are using our tests as well to help farmers in the developing world manage their herds. So we look at pregnancy and heat in cows. We can look for contamination in milk. And we look for aflatoxin in grain. So these are the staples that people need. Because it's very important to have your health, but it's also important to have a livelihood. And I think that increasingly it's going to be extremely important to think of health care, job care, and environmental care all together. Because I think that's going to be, you know, if your water's contaminated, if your job is not being productive, and if your health isn't good, any one of those three is going to affect your overall well-being. we have a very interesting program to me in sub-Saharan Africa on maternal health. The problems are almost exactly the same as in the US. I just went to an NIH meeting where preeclampsia, anemia, diabetes of pregnancy are the same problems that cause preterm birth. But here, as I said, you have to catch it before, while the woman can still walk to get help or to a clinic. We are very fortunately supported by DARPA and DITRA to make our molecular diagnostic approaches, which is quite hard on paper if you think about it. You've got to sample and amplify as well as read out on a piece of paper. We hook, everything we do is telemedicine compatible. As I said, in its very simplest form, you just take a picture. But we are working with Qualcomm on data capture and data analysis, because since my vaccine days, I have been very interested in making worldwide databases where we could track health and disease, but also track how our interventions change disease. When you make vaccines against the most prevalent strains of a disease, you actually change the profile of that disease such that the less prevalent strains now begin to come up. It's similar with drugs. If you inhibit an enzyme, you know, Michaelis Menten kinetics will tell you the most likely pathway for a substrate, but when you inhibit it, you begin to see alternative substrates worked on. So these things fascinate me. I like to track them. And somebody mentioned John Rogers. But we are working with a company locally in Cambridge called MC10. So in addition to reading things with cell phones and that kind of hookup for managing large quantities of data, we're now being able to put flexible electronics, LEDs and photodiodes and ribbon batteries, actually some chemical batteries, onto the paper so that we can get some quite accurate readouts on devices that are still disposable and still under 10 cents. So I think I've given you a sense of some of the sponsors that support this work. But one of the difficulties, I think, for really making changes to healthcare is to do them in a sustainable way. And there are an awful lot of people around with noble ideas, but it isn't sufficient to give a talk, to write a check, to work for a summer on a project. It's got to be something that's going to work day in, day out, and be self-improving and sustainable. And I spent a lot of time in biotech companies trying to do things on a worldwide basis. So I've had all the obvious ideas of tiered pricing, dual markets, all of these things. This is a new idea that I came up with for Diagnostics for All. Our purpose at DFA is to deliver useful diagnostics that are affordable to the developing world. And we don't want to be diverted or perverted from that mission. And almost all, I can challenge anyone in the room, almost all the methods of funding startup companies will involve an exit before you've done that. And I have run public companies and managed to do something like this, but it's called management distraction. But as long as you don't dilute your current shareholders, you can do it. So what we've done is made, we want, it's not that we don't care about the rich. They need healthcare too. So we need to provide things for people in the developed world, and we found that our technology is enormously appealing to some of the larger companies and other for-profit companies. So we have a wholly owned for-profit subsidiary, which keeps us sort of legal with the IRS. So this allows us to do regular partnering agreements of the type that I'm used to in the biotech industry with big pharmas, with other companies, even life insurance companies where you can get a profile of risk. And here, these are traditional partnering agreements, and we don't really care about the margin or the profit. Here, we do care. We care We don't want to make devices for a penny that are sold back to people for $100 or $1,000 or re-imported into the US. But so we can control that largely through governments. But we also can allow our technology to be used for for-profit uses. We pay the IRS and we pay Harvard, the latter being quite necessary and scrupulous about it. And then any benefit inures back to the original mission. So there is no deflection from the original mission by the needs of investors. So the shares of Paper Diagnostics are wholly owned by the nonprofit mission. So I just want to come back to saying people can do an awful lot to manage their own health, and it doesn't matter how clever we are. If we continue to escalate the cost of healthcare, it won't be available to everyone, and it probably won't be available to us. Thank you.